nothing is impossible. Some things are just less likely than others. This is a story about a machine. Its inevitable death. And those who still fought to save it. The Commodore Amiga was a range of home computers, popular in the late 1980s and early 90s. When the first model, the A1000, launched in 1985, it boasted incredible multimedia potential. With stereo sound, thousands of colors, and an advanced operating system with preemptive multitasking. The Amiga 500 in 1987 would define the system's success, however, wrapping this awesome potential into a more affordable package. Early Amiga titles were remarkably attractive. The full-color graphics of Defender of the Crown impressed, as did the cinematic adventure It Came from the Desert. The lush parallax-scrolling backgrounds of Shadow of the Beast and its atmospheric musical score are another highlight of the era. And each of these games were of a stark contrast to the rather basic 8-bit graphics that most were accustomed to at this time. This obvious bump in graphics helped the Amiga sales, with millions of A500s sold within the space of a few years. This popularity would usher in a golden age of the Amiga. Just ahead of the 16-bit consoles, a host of classic games emerged, both with fantastic visuals and sound for their time. Many fond memories were forged over games like Speedball 2 Brutal Deluxe, Turrican 2, and Swiv. And we were given a glimpse of the cinematic future of games, with titles like Another World. However, the rapid pace of technology amidst a competitive market meant that the Amiga's edge was soon eroded. It wasn't long before the A500 would be left behind. The arrival of the Sega Mega Drive and Nintendo Super NES put pressure on the low-cost end of the market, with Mario and Sonic's international presence drowning out the Amiga's often homegrown heroes. The business end of the market didn't bear much good news either, with the IBM-compatible PCs rapidly gathering steam. The upgraded A1200 and A4000 were released in late 1992. Faster hardware, with more RAM, and better graphics. The changes were iterative, however, not the revolution that the first Amigas brought. While the A1200 would prove moderately popular, the rising tide of alternatives, and some baffling corporate decisions, would eventually take their toll. In 1994, Commodore declared bankruptcy. Assets were liquidized, and the rights to the Amiga name passed on to a string of other companies over the next decade. But there would never be any new hardware. The Amiga was doomed. It was technically impressive. A system seller. And another nail in the Amiga's coffin. Doom marks a pivotal moment in PC gaming history, an emergence point for the popular first-person shooter genre. It's also jolly good fun. It's true, Wolfenstein 3D came before, and there are even older games which loosely fit the genre, but none would prove quite as popular as Doom. Although crude by today's standards, the game's 3D worlds had surprising atmosphere, with complex architecture, variable lighting, and a host of demonic denizens. Initially exclusive to the PC, other platforms looked upon Doom with envious eyes, with the Amiga amongst them. Even before Doom came along, the home computer was no stranger to the third dimension. Although such early 3D titles were invariably ugly, with flat-shaded polygons and glacial frame rates. RoboCop 3 is an interesting example that predates Doom. Its first-person perspective emulates RoboCop's point of view. And although the controls are slightly idiosyncratic, it fits most definitions of an FPS. Another movie tie-in game with FPS sections was Jurassic Park. Although graphically quite sparse, the threat of velociraptors lurking out of sight did make these 3D levels quite tense. Of course, once Doom hit peak popularity, there was a rush to replicate its success. The resultant wave of games were called Doom clones, before eventually solidifying as the FPS genre we know today. No system was safe, and intrepid Amiga programmers would attempt to create their own Doom clones, for the humble and slightly underpowered home computer. The Amiga's planar graphics hardware was geared towards fast scrolling and two-dimensional sprites, but it was otherwise ill-suited to the pixel-shoving grunt needed for generating texture-mapped worlds. Nonetheless, tech demos like Poom served as a proof of concept for an Amiga FPS. And the prognosis? Possible, albeit with some sacrifices. Gloom was a shameless take on Doom for the Amiga, but it was one of the more enjoyable ones, so it gets a pass for its unimaginative name. Fully texture mapped, and capable of running at a reasonable frame rate, even on a non-upgraded Amiga, albeit with very chunky pixels. Of particular note is the gore. Enemies explode into a shower of meaty chunks, along with a suitably wet sound effect. The ludicrous jibs might not be realistic, but they certainly add to the charm. Gloom Deluxe was released the following year, with some improvements and better support for faster Amigas. And with its blend of interesting level design, gratuitous violence, and classic shooter action, it's arguably the best offering amongst the first wave of Amiga FPS. Another big hitter in this arena was Team 17's Alien Breed 3D, a transition of the earlier Alien Breed's top-down perspective to a more immersive first-person one. It was big on atmosphere and had varied and interesting level designs, although distinctive areas are a necessity when your viewport is limited to such a small number of pixels. Nevertheless, it was a solid attempt, and while the game never sold as well as Team 17's earlier games, such as the better-known Worms, for the time, it was relatively successful. Fears was another attempt at emulating Doom success by a development group formed in the French demo scene. It ran well full screen, and unlike Gloom, even had multi-level architecture, albeit with a very narrow field of vision and an unusual projection. Notable for its peculiar demon baby opponents, and, quite frankly, anemic weapon animations. While the A1200 got the lion's share of FPS games, the older Amiga's larger install base, and greater potential sales. However, it also meant asking the near impossible from a decade-old architecture. The A500 was an able machine in its day, but any Doom clones that ran on it would have to make a serious compromise. Behind the Iron Gate was a valiant effort, even managing to maintain a decent frame rate. But the concessions made are clear, with the world and enemies rendered in various shades of blue and pink. Gameplay is reminiscent of early action-based RPGs like Dungeon Master, with familiar key-hunting puzzles to open locked doors. But with full freedom of movement and rudimentary texture mapping, it's definitely cast from the Doom mold. Also of note is the game's music, or rather, the musician. Adam Skorupa has gone on to compose music for many other games, including Bulletstorm and the Witcher series. Deathmask made a great effort to resemble Doom on the A500, but opted for grid-based movement within a pseudo-3D world. Any game with a double-barreled shotgun is not entirely without merit, but it is tough to enjoy an FPS when you can only look in four separate directions. Still, it did feature split-screen play, meaning that you and a friend could crowd round a single television and hunt each other down through the maze-like levels. Citadel is a more impressive effort. Fully texture-mapped, 360-degree movement, and it even runs on a 7MHz Amiga. Admittedly, on the lowest-end hardware, you were forced to play with a screen the size of a postage stamp, but scalability is nonetheless an admirable trait. Brutally hard, and with a more developed backstory than most games, this Polish Doom clone is ambitious in every aspect. These games stretched creaking hardware to its limit, an admirable achievement that the machine's prime time had long passed. And to remain relevant, developers would have to cater to more advanced hardware instead. With the death of the mainstream Amiga came the remnants of a hardcore few. And while no Commodore meant no new machines, there were still a few options left for those who wanted more horsepower. Third-party accelerator cards were an expensive but effective means of prolonging the Amiga's life, and games started to take advantage of this increased power. Alien Breed 3D got a sequel in The Killing Grounds, with higher resolution graphics and an increased hunger for RAM. It was a more visually impressive outing than the last, even if it did have more bugs. Sadly, by this time, the market for Amiga games was tiny. With only 5,000 copies sold, the age of any commercial Amiga releases was coming to a close. Games like NEMAC 4 were made for love rather than money. Small teams of independent coders interested in an exercise of technical accomplishment. Hailing from another small team in the Czech Republic, Testament was a satanic take on the genre, with spooky skeletons and beholders lurking within the textured world. Breathless was an impressive title, notable for its graphics, and part funding by an Amiga hardware reseller, with the game clearly intended to shift accelerator cards. An able FPS, it was more than a pretty face, with rave reviews in the Amiga press. But they were playing to a diminishing crowd, and it was becoming increasingly clear that there would be no savior. Finally, Genetic Species might be the pinnacle of native Amiga first-person shooters. Released in 1998, long after most had abandoned the machine. Because of this, it fully embraced higher-end hardware. And the game wouldn't look out of place on PC during a similar era. Sadly, its platform condemns it to a forgotten plane of gaming history. For all the effort expended on making a stylish FPS, very few would ever get to play it. With the PC utterly dominant and the dawn of 3D acceleration. In 1997, Doom's source code was released, spurring a flurry of mods, adaptations, and ports. The Amiga would finally get the real thing. Compiled and optimized for the hardware, it was playable on even a modestly expanded machine. And sure, it was several years late, but it remained a victory of sorts. The Doom engine was also the basis for Heretic and Hexen, and so these games were eventually ported to the Amiga 2. And in 1999, the Quake source code was released, again prompting an Amiga version. Since then, the occasional game finds its way to Commodore's machine, with Shogo Mobile Armor Division a surprising release for Amigas equipped with PowerPC CPUs. The slightly obscure FPS RPG Strife was even ported to the Amiga as recently as 2013, and I'd wager there were a few remaining souls eager to play it. Not with a bang, but with a whimper. The Amiga's death was neither quick nor complete. Even today, there remains a dim glow, the very last embers of the diehard. That the Amiga lasted as long as it did is testament to the ingenuity of a talented few. Those who could wrangle raw machine code and make hardware sing. Deep down they knew that the Amiga could never match the IBM compatibles in terms of power. Replicating the 3D visuals of Doom on stock Amiga hardware was impossible. But still, they tried. The independent, demo scene spirit of the home computer era drove these plucky few to push forward technical boundaries, to achieve the improbable through near-perfect execution. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, farewell.